It's the erosion that science has made in our moral fiber that I'm trying to combat. Understand it isn't really my theory. It's the theory that the ancients had right along, and I've just made a correlation with modern science and shown that current science, the most modern frontier, confirms this theory of an original divine spark, a monad, that starts it all off.
The process of invention begins as a potential. American philosopher Arthur Young began studying the problem of rotary wing flight in 1929. Working independently, Young spent 12 years testing and perfecting small aerodynamic models. In 1941, he took his successful design to the Bell Aircraft Company in Buffalo, where together they produced the Bell Model 47. This was America's first commercially licensed helicopter, and for 30 years it was the most widely used rotary wing craft in the Western world. But for Arthur Young, the helicopter was just the beginning. His role at Bell was finished by 1947, and having completed the helicopter, Young began to apply what he'd learned in the process of invention to problems of cosmology.
Purpose is what makes a machine. Now, some of these philosophers, some of them wouldn't know how to make a machine or even fix one, refer to man as a machine, by which they intend to imply that he doesn't have a purpose. Nothing could be more false, because there never was a machine that didn't have a purpose. In fact, I wonder if there ever was a purpose that doesn't need a machine to carry it out. It's that wedding of purpose and machinery that makes the world. But to say that you can't, because you can't see the purpose, therefore there's no such thing, is to miss the point. It's like mistaking the hand for the thing that it's pointing at.
For Arthur Young, questions of purpose and value are as essential to a complete picture of the universe as questions of space and time. And the way to get at these questions, in Young's way of thinking, is by making models. In the years since the helicopter was completed, Young has worked out a systematic theory of process, a theory that includes purpose, or first cause, as a formal ingredient. British author Colin Wilson has called Young's theory one of the most remarkable and constructive attempts to rebuild science in our own time.
A model is almost anything. A model is a paradigm, a model is a computer. Anything you put something in and get something out of. Now, the model may not be a correct model of the real situation. For instance, a pump is a model of the heart. And when people began to understand about pumps that they could begin to understand about the heart. And it's very similar to that all through our thinking. We need something we can play with to be able to understand what we ourselves are. We need problems. In order to evolve, we need problems. And we've been playing this game of hiding the truth for thousands of years so as to keep the thing going. It wouldn't do to solve all the problems. The world would just evaporate. We'd be back in heaven. We just have to start another mess. But I think things have gotten so messy now that it doesn't matter to take a peek at what's going on.
Young's theory of process began while he was an undergraduate in the mathematics department at Princeton. It was at that time he began to feel dissatisfied with the view of the universe provided by the theory of relativity. It was 30 years later that he developed his toroidal or donut-shaped model of the universe, a model which is only now coming into favor to explain problems in fundamental physics.
The theory of relativity describes the universe in terms of space-time and events distributed in space-time. You could think of them like dots on a Christmas tree or dots in space. Only the space includes not just three dimensions, but the dimension of time. Events in the future are listed as well as events now. So the whole thing becomes a rather static picture. But to me, I'd been through a very drastic personal experience in 1927, and time could not be represented as a structure. Time carried surprises, carried the unexpected. The direction of time was essential. So this led to my calling it a theory of time structure. And then I soon shifted to a theory of process. But at that time, I didn't have any concept of stages or finite number of stages, or especially that the stages should have a distinct character. If structure can be represented by this sphere, everything there, fixed in space-time, then this other dimension of folding in on itself, which is supplied by the torus, deals with this possibility of change, this growingness, because the growingness is not just the subsidence of an agitation that started with the Big Bang. It's a growing from within that the universe does to itself. The universe creates creatures that can grow and then move and eventually reflect on the nature of the universe. I'm a captive. But when we first came out to California in 1951, there was a great big sign advertising soap. This is the only soap that'll wash away the smell of other soaps.
Arthur Young explains that he took up the task of designing a helicopter as a way to train himself in the world of practical problems, as a way to test his theories against objective fact.
Really, if you must know, I went down to Washington to try to decide what to invent. I had a number of what I call armchair ideas, but the helicopter struck me as something worth going into because it would take quite a long time. That seems like backwards thinking, but I'd been familiar with radio, and I'd have an idea in radio and then read about it next month in the magazine. So I wanted to get something that took some time because it would enable me to catch up with the competition. And I think the helicopter was a good choice from that point of view because it took 10 years before I even got going. The power of model building I did not fully appreciate until later. For me, first, the model was a way to see, well, does it work? And then, of course, I wanted to make a big one. And I didn't have room or finances to make a big one, so I made a moderate-sized one that had all the vices of a big one and none of the virtues.
Young's first helicopter design called for several small propellers to pull round the main rotor blades. But after 7 years working on this configuration, he realized that this was the wrong approach entirely.
This took me back to small models. But now I'd learned how to simplify, or I was no longer intrigued with all these gearing problems. That's the way it is. Once you know how to do things, you lose interest in them. So I became more interested then, would it fly? And that meant that I had to make flights and have wrecks and do it all without losing my stride. Whereas many earlier helicopters had got their backing, and after years of working, put something together, and then had its trial flight, and the thing would crash, and then the backers backed out, and the project collapsed. But I realized that the energy had to come in after the crack-ups rather than before, because the crack-ups were teaching you something.
Arthur was older. He was the age of my sister, my older sister, and I was absolutely fascinated by the fact that he was a ham radio enthusiast. And this involved going to visit him.
Bart Kelly, a lifelong friend, worked with Arthur Young on the early experimental models. He later became head of engineering at Bell Helicopter Textron.
My mother used to say to me, "He's a very interesting boy. I wonder what's going to become of him." Because it was obvious then that he had a concentration, which I think everybody notices. In Radnor, in 1931, I remember the shop very well then because it was all new to me, very new to me. I used to be the one who took data and run the slide rule and so forth, and watched how he did it. It was tremendous, of course, there, to me, learning to get into the actual experimental method. I had been studying physics at Harvard, and the lab courses were terrible because you simply did experiments that had been planned for the whole class to do practically, and by a routine method. But the minute that started trying to help Arthur in the barn, it was real experiments, real, in the sense that you didn't know what was going to happen and you did want to find out.
The focus of Young's work with aerodynamic models was in the area of stability. Here, he made his first important contribution to rotary wing technology, the stabilizer bar. The bar controls the rotor and keeps it independent of the oscillations of the machine, in effect providing the helicopter with an artificial horizon. By 1941, the year Young took his helicopter design to the Bell Aircraft Company, more than 300 other companies had been trying to build rotary wing aircraft. Successful ships had been flown by Fokker in Germany, Sikorsky in America, and others, but a practical commercial helicopter was not yet a reality. At Bell, Young got to work on a full-scale machine based on his model, and soon the helicopter project was moved to its own location in Gardenville, New York. Here, the earliest Bell helicopter, the Model 30, was built. It was first tested by Young himself in 1943.
The reflexive universe and the process theory was obviously brewing, or something was brewing, nobody knew what. And, however, it was less manifest in that summer of 41. There was much more tension toward bringing the helicopter to a climax.
Way back, people used to ask me, well, what would be the use of a helicopter when I was trying to make models and stuff. And I was very impatient with that, trying to answer that question. It had nothing to do with what I was doing. I was trying to make one that worked. So I prepared a stock answer that it would be invaluable for oiling weather vanes. Actually, it wasn't such a silly answer after all, because one of the first uses that they made of the helicopter was to blow the dew from cherries.
It was the atom bomb that reminded me that I'd made a resolve to spend a limited time on the helicopter. And by 1945, I'd been in approximately 16 years. I couldn't leave at that time because the thing wasn't quite finished. But 2 years later, we had solved most of the production problems, and the ship was flying and had been in the hands of customers for 2 years, so there wasn't much left to... There's nothing for an inventor to do once the thing gets into production.
When I met Arthur, he was so busy with the helicopter that he was wanting to get away from the helicopter, and he was wanting to talk about the purpose of life, but he hadn't really developed a theory at all. But I could see, that's why I was drawn to him, because I could see that what he really cared about was, what is man here for? What are we for? And of course I was interested right away, because he was a probing person. He was somebody ready to go out and do something whether anyone believed in it or not. The helicopter, for instance, was, his father thought he was nuts to do it, I think, and his friends. They didn't pay much attention to him. He really worked for years and years on something that people thought was impossible.
The helicopter was my encounter with reality, and what were the laws and how do you fit them together. And I had 4 more years of apprenticeship, or I would say 6, from 1948 till 1954, which I call the gee whiz period. This was the period in my life where I was encountering psychic phenomena, mediums, radionics, all these things that weren't accounted for by the science that I was used to.
The atom bomb had a great effect on Arthur and me, both of us. I didn't know what to do about it, but I thought this meant it's really time for the human race to grow up. So we went to the UN to see what would be most useful to be done, and it did seem indeed that what was needed most was an international peace academy. So this we decided to set up. Well, the peace academy has gradually grown into something wonderful. I'm very excited about it. The purpose is to develop skills in mediation, negotiating, and peacekeeping, and whatever is needed to decide conflicts without war. Well, perhaps I should say we each have our role, and the best thing he can do is to work on his theory, which helps people understand their place in the universe and what the universe is really all about and what we're here for. And I feel that working for the Peace Academy, we're more likely to not blow ourselves up, more time to develop.
Arthur Young's theory of process is a formal analytical tool devised to answer questions normally considered outside the scope of scientific inquiry. It's a system having its own mathematical rigor, with a basis in number theory, geometry, and topology. Young relies heavily on the findings of physics, chemistry, and biology. He does, however, challenge what he calls the materialist assumptions of these sciences, the belief that everything can be explained on the basis of physical interaction. For Young is trying to integrate more than just the sciences. He is equally at home discussing his theory in terms of psychology, mythology, or symbolism. In the Reflexive Universe, he gives the postulates of the theory. The universe is a process put in motion by purpose. The development of process occurs in stages. There are 7 stages. Each stage develops a new power. Powers are cumulative. Each one retains the powers developed in the previous stages. Powers are evolved in what are called kingdoms. The 7 kingdoms, or stages of process, Young lays out on 4 levels around what he calls the arc. The world of physics, of matter and energy, is arranged on the left side of the arc. This world is divided into molecules, atoms, nuclear particles, and light, distinctions Young derives from what he calls the degrees of freedom inherent at each level of organization. The kingdoms of nature recognized by Aristotle, plants and animals, are placed on the right side of the ark, and with them an additional kingdom, man. The ark, then, is a representation of how the kingdoms of nature stand in relation to one another in a structure, but it also indicates a process in time and gives us an order in which the seven stages come into being. Light, which is without dimensional constraint, generates charged particles by what is called pair creation. These particles, organized in exact proportion, form atoms which in turn combine to create molecules. We thus have pictured on the left side of the arc a four-stage descent from the freedom of light to the constraint of matter. On the right side is pictured the return to freedom, first in plants, which can grow, then in animals, which can move, and finally in man, whose capacity for conscious reflection Young sees as mirroring the freedom of light. Young further believes that the stages of evolutionary progress are recapitulated in any ongoing creative process, art, music, or invention. Here, to a group of students, he describes the arc as it applies to human communication.
So let me illustrate with language what these seven stages would be. On the physical level, you have words. Instead of molecules, I can write words. And what are words? They're combinations of letters, just as molecules are combinations of atoms. So here would be words. Letters, W-O-R-D-S. I could take those letters and make a different word, like S-W-O-R-D, sword. Same letters made into a different word. You can do that with atoms, too. You take the same atoms and get a different combination, make a different molecule. But, and there are an almost infinite number of different words you could have, but there are only 26 letters. Remember, there were 92 atoms. So out of a finite alphabet, you're making an almost infinite number of combinations. Now, the letters themselves, 26 letters, are, let's say, straight lines and curves and various combinations. The point is that you're using something simple to get 26 different letters. And in the Morse code, it's just dots and dashes. In the computer, it's binary. That's the same kind of thing. So, okay, now I've got to the end of the road. This is binary. What's here? And that's what you can't specify. And if I say what the thought is, I haven't given you the option that you need here. This is free, open, do whatever you want. And it doesn't have any of this physical nature. It only borrows this physical vestment in order to get over to the other person.
Young's arc is arranged on four levels. This fourfold division, which he correlates with the Babylonian and Egyptian descriptions of man, as well as those of Jung and others, provides the structure for the analysis of process. The terms Arthur Young uses to describe his levels are purpose or intention, which can be represented as a point, force or value, the principle of attraction represented as a line, concept or form represented as a surface where structural relationships can be displayed, and object represented as three dimensions. Of these four, objects and forces, though different from one another, are both physical, while purpose and concept, both aspects of mind, are non-physical.
I need to illustrate things. I need to show you things. So I get, or shall I say, I create a blackboard. The blackboard is for the purpose of communication. Well, in order to make the blackboard, I have to have some material, and I have to cut it up according to a plan. So I need both the material and the
concept before I get the blackboard. Now, I said material without saying why that was a force. But I did say I need. The second stage is the needing. And it's always associated with some kind of substance. Then comes the plan. How big, you know, make it square, oblong. How do I hinge it? How do I put it so it'll move around? All that which is done by the drafting department, the planning department, is still concept. It isn't the final thing. And then when I combine the substance, the slate and the wood, according to the plan, I get the object, the thing.
A crucial feature in Jung's cosmology is what he calls the turn, represented on the arc as a right angle. This turn marks the point where involution, the descent from light into matter, changes to evolution. The turn is the origin of life, where the beginning of energy or information storage makes possible the first cellular organisms. In terms of mythology, this turn finds expression as rebirth, or the birth of the hero. Often, this is cited as a virgin birth, one without cause. In human evolution, the turn is the beginning of self-conscious reflection, of the ability to use laws rather than be used by them. To Arthur Jung, this is exemplified in the principle of inference.
Any thinking process that says, well, how did this happen? It has to use the principle of inference. Inference, well, if this happens, then this will happen. That thinking takes place in an inverted time sense. Let me see if I can show how that is. If I learn that A is the cause of B, then I can, wanting B, I can make A happen, so I'll get B. So it becomes, in brief, B, A, B. Suppose it was the fire causes cooking. Well, I think of how good it would be to have this nice cooked steak, so I make the fire in order to get the cooked steak. I've inverted the order. That inversion, turning around time, couldn't happen in the physical world. It has to happen in the mind. It's imaginary.
Another feature of the theory of process is the principle of isomorphism, whereby each of the kingdoms itself recapitulates the same stages as does the whole process. As an example, the animal kingdom begins with unicellular organisms. Next come multicellular creatures, which as yet have no organs or tissue differentiation. Then animals having a single organ, a stomach, and hence a primitive identity, an inside and an outside. In a similar way, an atom is the simplest entity to have its own center. At the fourth stage come animals with combinations of organs, arranged non-hierarchically. Here, having solved the problem of digestion, the animal takes up the problem of mobility. At the fifth, or growth substage, the organs are first arranged sequentially, what's called metamerization. At the sixth, segmented side chains are added, making possible greater range and mobility. And finally, at the seventh substage, the spinal column is formed, and with it, the central nervous system. In its structural mapping of the various levels, the theory of process is quite unique. Jung takes issue with the new attempt to fuse physics and the life sciences in what is becoming known as the emergent paradigm.
Emergent paradigm is saying conscious Consciousness is an epiphenomena. You put all these molecules and stuff together, and there's some kind of steam comes out of it, or some vapor, and that's consciousness. There's something emerges from all the molecules that you couldn't explain. Now, in other words, it's a consequence of the molecular activity, but it wasn't there in the first place. Whereas I would insist that the consciousness is there in the first place, and the molecules are a later development, or the atoms, actually, and then the molecules. I'd like to show you another interesting fourness. It's rather one of the stranger ones. You start out making a map of England, or a map of London, on one city block of London. Or you could think of the girl on the cracker box, but maybe the map, let's say that's England, and this is, or London, and this is the block that you're making the map on, and there's some features here, well, those must be there. But when you get to making the block, then you have to have a little block. And then in that block, you have a still littler block. And this goes on and on forever. And it's supposed to be an eternal regression, a paradox, and so forth. And I thought about it a lot. And what I came up with was that there's a difference in time. You see, you say, here is London, and that's the way things are. And then you start to make a map of that. Well, you're beginning to put new stuff in, so it's in different time, and essentially that new map is displaced from this. You could think of it as lifted off, but you'll see why I've moved it over to the side too. In other words, it's not on the same plane. It's in a different time. And the next one would be the map of the map would be displaced again. And if you think of this as an eternal regression, you'd get a whole sequence of these things going on and on and on.
The situation in science now is that equipment, data, and information has become so specialized that people even within a given discipline, say of biology or physics or chemistry, can't even read other papers and other publications within that discipline.
And the result this is Dr. Kenneth Pelletier, clinical psychologist and author on the subject of holistic medicine. He is one of a growing number of professionals who have applied Arthur Young's theory of process in their work.
To me, one of the most important questions right now is the nature of the mind-body interaction. And the way that the theory helps us to understand that is to have two separate but interacting systems. And the property of consciousness vis-a-vis the physical brain, I think, is a very graphic example of this kind of interaction that would be both predicted and consistent with the theory. One of the best sources of information on this would be when Wilder Penfield was doing the electrical stimulation of the brain work. One of the things that he could do was to stimulate the sensory motor cortex and produce a finger movement in a person who is totally conscious because the brain has no pain receptors. And when he would do this, he would stimulate an area of the brain, you would get a finger flexion. And then you would ask the person, is that like moving your own hand? And consistently, the person would say, no. It was as though someone held my finger and moved it involuntarily. So we begin to get, on this basis, a very subtle but very important difference between purposive, willed, conscious action and an action which appears to be imposed externally on the physical central nervous system. And when you have these two separate but interacting levels is something, again, that is consistent, predicted by the theory, and yet is quite inconsistent with our previous scientific model.
The theory of process, to me, a lot of people have talked about it as being a map, but to me it's a language. And as a language, it needs to be learned like a language. One has to transform their minds.
Joan Schleicher is an art historian and specialist in mythology. Her work has been in the area of interpreting art and myth as they symbolize the process of human evolution.
You can't just come in and learn the theory of process. You can't just memorize the seven categories and all the different animal kingdoms and various species and things like that that fit in the cubbyholes, the categories. That isn't understanding the theory of process at all. In order to do that, you have to start taking it on yourself so that it's almost one with the way that your mind thinks. Then you can start applying it and benefiting from it. The sciences, on the other hand, all speak different languages. Age of specialization has created all these different disciplines that all have a very, very refined and esoteric language that creates a situation that the psychiatrist, the psychologist can't talk to the physicist, the biologist can't talk to the literary specialist or the philologist or the logician perhaps. They're all making their discoveries, but no one can transmit their discoveries to the other discipline. And it seems to me the only reason that they all went apart to begin with was to try and do their job better of understanding the nature of reality.
This is Dr. Frank Barr, physician and brain researcher.
Some parts of the theory are beyond proving. They're not subject to objective study. And that's what makes this thing so beautiful. It just shows that some things are beyond the realm of science. And everybody knows that. Every time you try to find the self thing that you are, you keep going one further. You know it's behind your eyes. You think, oh, I'm behind my eyes. And you keep trying to grasp it. And everything you grasp is only a concept. And so there's something still there trying to grasp something else, like G. Spencer Brown says. One part of the universe will always be unknown to the other part. So every time you try to grasp anything conceptually, you chop off the part that's trying to grasp. And science, of course, doesn't want to deal with that at all.
Frank Barr has carried the theory of process into areas undreamed of by its creator. In Jung's theory, a striking feature is the importance of light as first cause. Barr realized that in his own field, biological systems, every interaction is due to the exchange of photons, or quanta of light, at the atomic level. This led him to look closely at the molecules in the body which absorb light, the pigments, mainly melanin. And these molecules, Barr has concluded, play a much more important role in bodily organization than is generally suspected. The theory of process, in Dr. Barr's estimation, offers predictive and testable hypotheses in the areas of cellular and developmental biology and brain research. Barr's own conclusions have broad implications for tissue regeneration and treatment of schizophrenia. He hopes that by applying the theory, he will be able to explain many apparently unconnected empirical findings in a systematic and integrative framework.
Come on, should we have it right?
Oh God, here we go. What, this kind?
Yeah.
This is what he beats me at.
Now we can't both relax. You're always so relaxed.
For several years I've been working as a therapist, actually working to help open people up and help deal with their disorders simply by helping them discriminate between the levels of themselves and between the relationships between the levels, both on an energy level and by working on the neuromuscular structure in movement and by gently working on their bodies.
Stuart Heller's work is an example of how the theory of process can be used to reconcile seemingly dissimilar bodies of thought. Heller has trained in the Alexander technique, the Feldenkrais method, and other modern systems of body integration. But it was by applying the theory of process that he was able to formally equate these theories and communicate them to his students.
How does Mozart get to be Mozart? How do you get to be of sufficient competence to immediately start as an infant learning complex behavior patterns that you couldn't teach now? I have to say that the human evolution in
involves the evolution of many lifetimes, not only as a human, but as an animal and as a plant, molecule, so maybe through many universes. I can't prove this, but what I'm doing is setting up a system in which the, you might say it's a minimum requirement, because instead of requiring it all to come in jumps of with no explanation, you're doing it gradually.
On the question of the relationship of the theory to, say, spiritual traditions, we've emphasized a lot the grounding in science. This view of the universe that he has, this kind of fourfold view of the universe, is really anchored at two ends. It's anchored in the at the physical end, where matter is congealed, but it, in an ultimate sense, it's anchored at the spiritual end, which is the source and the goal of all of process. So that in a real sense, the theory of process is could be described almost as a New Age religion as well as a New Age science. And the problem is that our vocabulary is not yet developed to deal with something that is both religion and science. I've been asking myself, what is it that really is the essential core of Arthur's theory, the theory of process? And my conclusion is that it probably the best description of it comes through the view it provides on evolution, the process of evolution, and that is coded into a very simple symbol, the symbol of the arc and the four levels. I think we in time we will appreciate that the arc is really a symbol which has meaning coded into it, and that in effect is the guiding clue to how evolution functions.
What is the freedom of the plant? I represent it in the book as an arrow going to heaven. It's a sort of aspiration. It's the plant reaching for light. In technical terms, it's heliotropism, turning toward the light. Animal I represent as a circle with an arrow that can be moved around. Choice. Should I chase that rabbit or that rabbit? The animal has this problem of which mate, which food, which chase, should I run or should I fight, which the plant doesn't have. Now, what's interesting, I mean, what's characterized this is that it's open, it's free, it can be infinite. This, while finite, is free in an angular fashion as to go this way or that way. So the combination would be what? So here are different goals, but in a limited scope. Here's an infinite goal, but in a single direction. So if you combine the freedoms, you get infinite goals in any direction. And that is what would characterize this creature, infinite goals in any direction. Now, does man live up to that or not? As an animal, you're exploring the possibilities of different kind of tools, a woodpecker, an elephant, endless varieties. The senses of animals are remarkable. An owl uses radar. A bat uses sonar. But man isn't very good at any of these specialties. He makes up for it by making tools. He moves from being something to having it. In other words, instead of being a bird, he can have the use of an airplane. Or instead of specializing in rapid running,
he can get an automobile. He doesn't specialize anymore. And that means his being is freed so that it can devote itself to, shall we say, metaphysics. There's something beyond the immediate needs of sustaining himself. Well, what kind of evolution is that? It's not accounted for by Darwinian evolution. It's not accounted for by evolution of species. It means that there must be some way to account for the increasing competence that we learn as persons.
This concept of purpose as the force that drives through and organizes evolution at a non-tangible level, in other words, something that directs the evolutionary process, which is not confined to random genetic mutation, is something that is not admissible in our previous science. And yet it is clearly a requirement if you look at the trend of evolution over time. If you look at the fact that birds had hollow bones, which is maladaptive in an evolutionary sense, and yet the hollow bone structures occurred maybe thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of years before flight was possible, indicates that there was a purpose in developing the hollow bone apparatus to gain the quality of flight.
Humans start out with a sort of group soul, which is one of the reasons why humans are gathered together in tribes, and you find this very primitive people have sort of ESP between members of the tribe. They act the way you spoke about the ant colony. They act as though they were part of a larger organism. Then the problem for the human, in my view of process, is to individuate and have his own soul. And this is not really accomplished until the sixth substage of the human, even beyond us. We're still mixed up between the group instincts all around us and our own individuation. And that's one of the reasons that the ego is one of the important things in human evolution. Many of these development schools want you to smash the ego or something. But it's really smashing the ego as a compulsive trait. Not really smashing it all together, because then you wouldn't have anything to evolve.
What does that say about, say, reincarnation, Arthur? I mean, are we reincarnated? And if so, what is it that persists? What is the substance that persists between our incarnations if we haven't yet developed a soul?
Well, I have to say it does persist, but we're not appreciating it, you see. And this is why the karma is somewhat compulsive. Suppose, they always take the example of somebody that blinded, was an executioner or something, did something cruel to others, and then in his next life he wants to balance the budget so other people are cruel to him. But in a sense, that's such a compulsive thing, it's almost like electricity. I mean, there's nothing much you can do about it. But it's said by those who talk about these things that karma can be changed very quickly. You just realization. That beautiful story about Jack Swartz, who was being beaten by a Gestapo or something, and he looked up and said, "I love you." And the other guy just collapsed. The one who was beating him. But Jack Swartz was clairvoyant from that point on. He'd made a quantum jump in his evolution. He might have gone wrestling, you know, he would have beaten the other person in his next life and so on. But realizing that this doesn't have to go on, mm-hmm. saves him from the compulsive nature. And I think that's what our evolution is, to free ourselves from compulsions.
I found the theory of process capable of organizing what I had already experienced. And for me, that's sufficient. That we're dealing here not with consequences, but rather the ground from which one views the universe. I think what's very important to distinguish the provable facts, which by the very definition of the word proof means that there's something which you hold fundamental, some axiom, some statements which you can't even question, and you can never prove them. It seems to me what the theory of process presents to us is, in a sense, a set of axioms in terms of which we view the universe.
The young man asked the wise old woman, what did the universe rest on? Rested on the backs of four elephants. Well, what were the elephants standing on? Well, they were standing on the backs of four turtles. What were the turtles standing on? They were standing on four rocks. Well, what were the rocks standing on? She said, young man, it's rocks all the way down.
Now, the real strength of the argument about soul is not to get into this difficult position of saying, well, how can the soul survive the death? But to reverse it and say, how is it possible for anything to be destroyed? Science is quite accustomed to dealing with things that can't be destroyed. Mass, energy, conservation of charge, conservation of momentum, all these things can't be destroyed. So the question, when you narrow it down to the one of, well, what is it that can be destroyed, it becomes quite obvious that something that's constructed can be deconstructed. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If you put things together, let's say out of bricks, then you can knock them apart. But you can't destroy the substance of the break. So if you think of the soul as that primary substance out of which things are formed, then death doesn't eliminate it. It simply changes its form.
And Aristotle tried to say the soul was formed, that it was in here. Now what happens when you destroy something? I'm going to destroy this piece of chalk.
Destroy its form.
Now, destroyed the form. What happens to the substance?
You diminish the diminish.
Its substance lingers on.
You proved your point. I got it.
Punch, Bill. A glass of punch.
I went through agonies when I first got interested in Buddhism and Zen, reading these remarkable teachings, telling me about the egolessness of things and the egolessness of persons. I just couldn't understand it. What was this helicopter I was making? Did it have no selfhood? Did I have no selfhood? It was very difficult pill to swallow. I gradually began to recognize then that the helicopter wasn't a thing. It was something you moved toward. It was a goal. Any particular model was already obsolete as soon as you'd made it. And you keep moving on. So the real thing is the dynamic that's pushing it on. And this form is something that's peeled off and thrown away when you're finished with it. I remember looking out the airplane window at the bird and watching the bird. I'd always thought, wouldn't it be nice to be a bird? But I realized that bird is always trying to get somewhere. And you don't get anywhere by flying there any better than by getting some other way. The thing is, to be where you are, to be free without having to go somewhere else.